Hey there, welcome. In this episode, we're diving into the exciting world of 3D modeling for our architecture project. We're going to try out all sorts of modeling techniques using those handy tools we learned about before. Isn't that awesome? We'll see which method works best for capturing the form of this building, and, you know, we'll figure out if there's even a difference at all. So, come on, let's get started. So I'm Hossein, and welcome to the fourth and final episode of our super condensed Rhino course for beginners. In this course, right, in the first episode, we dove into the logic of digital design and got familiar with the software environment. Then, in the second episode, we learned how to draw accurately and build a solid mental foundation for modeling. Oh, and in episode three, we tackled transforming curves and lines into surfaces and volumes, creating those complex forms using different commands. And now, in this episode, we're going to explore various methods to achieve an architectural form. We'll look at their differences and figure out which path is the most accurate. All right, so during the video, you're going to get familiar with some super handy and advanced commands, right? This course is really focused on the basics, but oh my gosh, Rhino has way more features. In the future, we'll dive into each one of those in project-based videos and see how they all work together. And hey, if you liked this content and haven't subscribed yet, you totally should. Don't forget to hit that bell so you won't miss any of the upcoming videos, because trust me, there's going to be a lot more educational content coming your way. Okay, so before we dive into modeling, there's this really important thing I got to mention. If we're going to set a rule for ourselves, the first one has to be, when you come across a new model, don't panic. I mean, seriously, a lot of times these forms look super complicated and tough at first glance, right? But then you take a moment, just a moment, to really look at them, and you realize they're way simpler than you initially thought. All right, so like the thing you really got to do when you're modeling, right, is simplify the form in your mind, you know? Just imagine it. Try to see what parts it's made of, what elements are there. Like when I look at this model, the first thing I do is totally ignore the contoured part and I really focus on seeing the main shape. What I see is like a square section that's been rotated about 90 degrees, you know? And if you look closely, you can even spot the window frame. And then after that, the contours of the facade get added in. It's pretty wild. Okay, so first up, we're using the loft command, right? So here's the deal. I'm going to draw a rectangular section, like 10 by 20, and then I'll copy that along the axis four times, just like that. And I want the distance from the first to the last section to be about 75. But, you know, those numbers, totally flexible. You can change them based on what you need or like your personal style. Now, out of those sections, I'm going to take two and rotate them 90 degrees using the gumball command just to get that shape I'm after. You know, then I'll run the loft command and hit enter. At this point, you've got to specify the path for creating the surface. Got it? Cool. Okay, so here's the thing you really got to know about computers and like creating shapes, right? So computers, they don't actually grasp the concept of a shape or a line. You know, everything is just like numbers and binary to them. So when we draw a rectangle, it's basically just four points with specific coordinates that get stored in a list, like in order. And then they connect those points in that order to like create the rectangle for us. Crazy, right? That's why the order of the points and how you draw them is super crucial, especially when you're trying to do a loft. Like, wow, it all makes sense. Okay, so in the image you see here, I like wrote an algorithm in Grasshopper that shows the number of each point, right? So it starts counting from zero, which means point zero is actually the starting point of the line. But hey, don't worry, you don't need to know Grasshopper right now. In the future, We're totally going to start from absolute zero in this channel, step by step, super simple. So if you haven't subscribed yet, like seriously do it now so you don't miss out on the upcoming videos. All right, so let's dive into Loft, yeah? When you hit that Loft button, the software like needs to know which point from the first section connects to which point in the next, right? So for example, does point zero connect to point zero or point one? It's crucial. I mean, really. And here's the kicker. You can even flip the direction of the lines in each section. Just click on flip and bam, the line direction changes. This totally impacts the final shape, like no joke. In a lot of cases, this little detail can mess up your surfaces or create some bizarre final form. So seriously, keep an eye on the line directions. It's super important. So once everything's all set up, right, and we've mapped out the loft path according to the picture, we just hit enter. And then, wow, you get to see the form preview. It's super exciting. You can switch up the mode to pick the type of loft you want. Personally, I usually go with loose. And just like that, you start creating the initial surface. I'm going to go through this path again, but like this time, instead of just a simple rectangle, I'm going to draw something with way more detail, you know? So I'll use the offset command to create a parallel line. And then I'll throw in a few smaller lines. I'll trim those up. And in the end, I'll join everything together to make sure I've got a closed curve. And trust me, the result is going to be so much better and cleaner. I'm going to go over this path one more time, right? And like every single time, I'm going to apply these changes you see to each step. It's kind of like we set something up similar to a hatch, you know? In the final stage, it's time to, you know, contour the model. So I'm using the contour command, right? I pick the form and just hit enter. Now I need to like specify the contour direction. It's got to be perpendicular to the sections, you know, because if you pick an angle, your sections are going to be all wonky. It's better to use ortho to draw a straight line for sure. Then I'm setting the distance for the contours. I'm going with 1 meter here. Once the contouring is done, the lines are automatically selected, which is super handy. So right here, just use the group command to group them together so you can manage them easier later. If you skip this step and lose your selection, oh man, you'll have to select them one by one. And let me tell you, that's a real hassle in big projects. All right, so now we're just at one last step, right? We're going to take those contour lines and turn them into a solid volume using the extrude closed curve command. Super simple. So I'm going to set the extrude value to match that contour distance. So there's literally no gap between the surfaces. And that's it. Our architectural form is ready to go. Congrats. You've totally nailed building this model using the loft method. Now let's dive into the second method. All right. So like the second method, it's the twist command, right? So we're using the same section that we drew in the last method. Got it? And I'm extruding it to like the length we want, which in this case is 75. Super simple, just to get a basic shape, you know? Now, if I hold down Control and Shift on the keyboard, I can pick the edge I want and move it around with Gumball to change the form a bit. But here's the main part. We're using the twist command. Just as the name suggests, it's all about twisting an object around a specific axis. All right, so here's how it works, right? First, you pick the object and then you just hit enter. Easy enough, right? Then the software is going to ask for the rotation axis. Now, I want this axis to go through the center of the shape, so I'm drawing it out just like in the picture. For extra precision, I'm using OSNAP and Smart Track, which makes it way easier to place points accurately. Oh, and here's a super important tip. The placement of the twist axis has a huge impact on the outcome. I totally recommend practicing a few times and trying the axis in different spots to see how the shape changes. It's kind of fascinating, honestly. After we pinpoint the axis, it's kind of like the rotate command, right? We got to specify the starting point and the end point for the angle of rotation. It's like super similar to this thing we call chilling the form, you know? So I'm rotating this form around 90 degrees, and just like that, we get the initial shape. And then, just like before, we only need to use the contour and extrude commands to reach the final form. And hey, that's the second modeling method. But wait, we're not done yet. Let's dive into the third method for creating the same architectural form. All right, so here we go, right? The third method, cage edit, yeah? So just like before, I'm going to redraw that same section we had, and then, get this, I extrude it to our desired length, which was like 75. And again, by holding Control plus Shift on the keyboard, I can pick that edge I want, and with Gumball, I just move it around a bit to change the shape, you know? But this time, we're diving into the cage edit command. You can totally find this command by searching in the command line or like check out the tools menu at the top of the screen. Super easy. Okay, so like the cage edit thing, it's kind of like building this cage or, you know, a 3D framework around your model, right? And then when you move those points of the cage, the whole model just like bends and flexes super smoothly. Instead of like directly moving the control points of your model, you create a simpler structure like a box or a curved grid, you know? And any change you make to that, it applies to the entire model. It's really versatile. Like when you want to tweak a complex shape without messing up its topology, or if you're trying to make something hard like a car body or a chair feel more organic, right? And you can even change multiple objects at once without having to edit them one by one. All right, so here we go with the instructions, right? First, I'm going to type in cage edit and then hit enter. Then I select the object and, you guessed it, hit enter again. Now for the next step, I'm choosing the bounding box option for select control object. Pretty straightforward, huh? And then, oh, in the coordinate system, I'm going with CP plane. Now it's asking me how many control points to set up in each axis, X, Y, and Z. So for X, I'm putting in 4. For Y, I'm going with 2. And for Z, another 2. After that, just hit enter again. Oh, and in the region section, I'm keeping it on global, and you guessed it, hitting enter once more. Easy peasy. Okay, so you see now there are these points appearing on the form, right? Every movement you give to these points, it directly impacts the entire form. So like, I'm going to select half of the object's points, and using Gumball, I'm going to twist it about 90 degrees. If I need to shift anything, I'll just do it right here. The main form is pretty much taking shape now. And then, just like in the previous two methods, I only need to use the contour command and then extrude to get to the final form. And there you have it. Method 3. But wait, we're not done yet. Let's dive into the fourth method for modeling this architectural form. All right, so check it out. This fourth method, right? It's like the simplest and quickest one out of the four. But hey, it might not be the most precise, you know? So we take that little section we drew before, and guess what? We just redraw it, then extrude it to our desired length, which is 75. Super easy, right? Then, while holding down Control and Shift, I can totally select an edge of the model and like move it around with Gumball to change the shape. How cool is that? Next up, I pick the last edge of the shape the same way and rotate it 90 degrees with Gumball. If I need to, I can shift it a bit to get to that final form I want. And that's it, just like that. All right, so what you just saw, right? It was like four totally different ways to model an architectural form. Some of these methods are like way more complex, but super precise. And others are quicker, but, you know, not as accurate. The truth is, there's no such thing as an absolute right way. The right method is honestly the one that feels the most comfortable for you, where you can actually get to the result you want, you know? With practice and experience, you kind of get there over time. Sometimes speed is more important for you and you just want to whip out your idea quickly, while in other projects, that final accuracy really matters and you got to spend more time on it. In the image you see, you can totally see the qualitative differences in the output of each of those four methods, and you can compare them. It's pretty fascinating, right? So, like, I just want to say a huge thank you for joining me on this intense four-part journey. Seriously, it's been a blast. In this series, I tried to cover all the essentials you need to kickstart your modeling in Rhino. But oh man, there's still so much to dive into. I mean, we've got layering, scene settings, advanced editing tools, and the latest Rhino features. All of that, we're totally going to tackle it together in future videos in a super fun, project-based way. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to hit that like button, subscribe, and share it with your friends so they can join in too. And like, I really want to hear from you, so drop your thoughts in the comments. It'll help me create even better tutorials for you. Until next time, take care.